cuta wuta ta gani ta kukan ma.
Hey guys, welcome back to our channel. It's your girlfriend Lungu back with another reaction video. If you're new to this channel, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course do not forget to subscribe. A big shout out to the person that suggested this. They suggested I react to Does the Quran Guarantee the Rights of Non-Muslims? So without wasting time, let's get into the video.
Dr. Shabir Ali, welcome to Let the Quran Speak.
Pleasure as usual.
How does the Quran talk about people who are not Muslims?
Well, look, the Quran shows that all people are honorable in the sight of God. The Quran says, "Laqad karramna bani Adam." So this is very general. It includes all people, Muslims or non-Muslims.
Mm-hmm. Does it say anything about the way Muslims should view other people?
Yes, it tells us to respect people because God has given to all people some kind of religious guidance, religious traditions. The fifth chapter of the Quran, the 48th verse, actually says that God is going to try every people with reference to the guidance that God has given them. So we should live and let live. The Quran puts it, "Fastabiqul khayrat," so race with each other in doing good things, and then you know that you will eventually return to God, and He's going to judge, be the ultimate judge of who was right and who was wrong about religious and theological differences.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I noticed in the Quran that there's some reference to the fact that Allah created us different. You know, mm-hmm. God created us in different ways, in different communities. And if He had wanted, if God had wanted, God could have made us all the same.
Exactly. But that was obviously not His intention. So the 49th chapter of the Quran, the 13th verse, speaks exactly to this and says, "The most noble of you in the sight of God is those who are more conscious of God." And this consciousness of God is not something we can measure. And it's across religions. Like across religions, you will notice that some people have the fever of religion. People are very devout, very sincere, sacrificing themselves and their property for God. You read stories about people who devoted themselves to worship in caves. The story, for example, of a man who was not a Muslim, but the only thing he owned was a copy of the gospel. And then eventually he sold the gospel to get money so he can give it to the poor. So, you know, these are stories of devotion showing that what we call piety or taqwa, this goes across the world, across religions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, Islamophobes often say, you know, Muslims don't like non-Muslims, but not just that. That they're either, you know, that Islam preaches that we should either kill them or convert them. So, you know, what are your thoughts on that? What does the Quran say about how we should deal with non-Muslims?
Well, first of all, we cannot kill them because the Quran is very clear that you cannot take the life of any innocent human being. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, no, we don't have to convert them. We don't have a stipulation in the Quran that says that all people must be become Muslim. Mm-hmm. No, we do have an obligation to preach the message of Islam to all and sundry. But then it is very clear from the Quran that we cannot force people into the religion. Surah 2 verse 256 says, "La ikraha fid din," and this is an absolute statement. There is no compulsion in religion. And several other verses of the Quran say, for example, that if God wanted, He could have made you all one community. Are you then going to force people to become Muslim? Mm-hmm. But God has left it so you can't force people. The Quran tells the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, "Laysta alayhim bi musaytir." You are not a supervisor over people, so you can just simply give the message. Wa ma ala rasuli illa al-balagh. The messenger has only the responsibility to deliver the message, nothing more than this. His mm-hmm. job is done. It's up to people to accept or not accept, and to a certain extent, it is even up to God, because God tells the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Quran, "Innaka la tahdi man ahbabta, walakin Allah yahdi man yasha." You cannot guide those whom you love. It is only God who guides whom He wishes. Mm-hmm. It's a two-way street. The person chooses the right path, and God is guiding the person in the right path. But the one who's delivering the message, whether it is the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, or us as his followers, we can only deliver the message. We can't force people to believe in that message.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about how non-Muslims would be viewed societally. So how would a society, let's say a Muslim-majority society, how should they treat non-Muslims? So Islamophobes often bring up this term, dhimmis. and they talk about jizya as well. So tell me what those terms are and whether they have any relationship to the Quran.
Okay, starting with the first part of your question, the very basic principles of ethics and moral guidance that Muslims are taught to live by, truthfulness, honesty, self-sacrifice, caring for other people, all of this goes across the board. It's not limited to, it's not like, you know, you be truthful to Muslims and lying to non-Muslims. It cannot work that way because either you're truth teller or you're a liar. You can't have it both ways. And Muslims are taught to be like truthful, honest, sincere, devout, and good to all of God's creatures, including obviously non-Muslims. Now, in the past societies, there was a definite division between people of a variety of tribes and different affiliations. And these divisions were marked. Societies were all separate, and people went to war with each other at the drop of a hat, each threatening to engulf the other or leaving themselves as sitting ducks waiting to be engulfed by somebody else. Mm-hmm. So everyone was at each other's throats, everybody vying for ascendancy and triumph. That's very different from our modern nation states in which we have learned to live and let live.
For the most part,
yes, and we have drawn up border lines, and we don't interfere with somebody else's country and their wealth and so on. Now, in the time of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the Quranic revelation, naturally things were in a state of evolution towards what we now have achieved in our present day. So we cannot expect that everything that is stated in the Quran or demonstrated in the life experience of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, would correspond to our modern experience. But we can see that it's growing and developing towards that. We can see that, for example, the Quran insists that Muslims must protect non-Muslims who come to live among them. That's in the 9th chapter of the Quran, the 6th verse. In the 60th chapter of the Quran, also in the 6th verse, God tells us to be just to people who are not fighting against us on account of our religion and who did not drive us out of our homes on account of our religion. So, antabarruhum wa tuqsitu ilayhim. So you are to be kind to them and you are to be just and fair to them because God loves those who are just. So that should be the Muslim characteristic. Being just. As for this thing about what they're calling dhimmitude, this refers to a status that was given to non-Muslim minorities in a Muslim society. Mm-hmm. One may view it negatively today because it marks off a certain people as different, and we wouldn't do that in a modern society. And certainly in many of the Muslim states in the world, this category is now being diminished, and people are regarded as equal citizens without this kind of religious distinction. But what that meant at the time was that these people would be protected at a time when they would not have been given protection otherwise. If we think up until the Middle Ages, when Muslims were being massacred in Spain and Jews were being massacred in Spain. Well, this is even closer to our modern times. We have to think back to 1,400 years ago, the time of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So modern sensitivities were not in place. And if non-Muslims were given a safe haven to live among Muslims, that was actually quite an advance. And that advance was represented so that David Bamberger, in his book, Judaism and the World Religions, was able to say that in the Middle Ages, in Spain, the Jews enjoyed what is referred to as the Golden Age of Judaism, in that while Jews were being persecuted by others, they were safe among Muslims. Mm. So that's a reflection of that, what is called disparagingly, dhimmitude by the modern Islamophobes. This was the sense that Muslims had that they must protect these people. So the Ahlu Dhimma, from which the term Dhimmi comes, is really the people who have made a covenant. So they are in a covenantal relationship with Muslims so that Muslims will protect them, and they are guaranteeing that they are also not at war with the Muslims, as opposed to others of their ilk who could be at war with Muslims, but they are a protected minority.
Mm-hmm. So tell me about the jizya then. How does that work?
Jizya refers to a certain tax which was levied on the dhimmis, or this protected minority, and that was in place of what Muslims Muslims had to pay. In every state, everybody pays taxes, Muslims or non-Muslims, and the taxes are used for the public welfare. So Muslims would pay a certain tax, which is referred to as zakat, and the non-Muslims would pay a tax, which is referred to as jizya. And
so is it a similar amount?
It varied because they calculated differently. Mm-hmm. The zimi tax was usually a head tax, so much per person, and then alleviated in case there was no need for it, or in case a person individually, like the individual, was too old, unable to work or something like that, so they didn't have to pay a tax. The Muslim tax is calculated differently, and it's based on the net worth at the end of the year, in a simple calculation. So you would pay 2.5% of that. So the Muslim tax could be more, or the Zimi tax could be more, depending on circumstances as economies change and evolve. But it was not the purpose of the Zimi tax to be more than the Muslim tax. It was just a different tax. And why a different tax? Because many jurists interpreted the zakat that Muslims pay as a religious obligation, as opposed to a simple tax that we all pay in a modern state in which religion may not have anything to do with it.
So then for those who didn't have a religious obligation, there needed to be another reason.
A non-religious tax, yes, which was the jizya. Mm-hmm. So it was thought unconscionable that if you're going to ask a non-Muslim to pay the zakat, which for a Muslim is a pillar of the faith, it's as if the non-Muslim would be made to subscribe to a certain pillar of the Muslim faith, mm-hmm. and they could have a conscientious objection to that. So the simple matter was that they paid a different tax, which was called by a different name, a jizya, and it represented the idea that if the Muslims had to go to war, the Muslim soldiers will go to war, and to defend the Muslims and the non-Muslim protected minority who were living among Muslims. And then the non-Muslim protected minority would not be drafted into the army. Mm-hmm. So if we think about a modern army like the United States of America having an army who goes around the world, and those army buddies have to be fed, and their families have to be looked after at home. So that their salaries will come from out of the state treasury, and the state treasury is funded by the taxation.
So very quickly, if we have let's say we have a Muslim majority state, how should non-Muslims be treated in that state?
Well, they should be treated as equal citizens. The old ways of categorizing people is based on the way in which society was governed at that time. The modern way in which the world has become a global village, where people interact with each other and there is rapid travel, and people, you know, are interlaced, and Muslims and non-Muslims together in the same society, such as we have in Canada. This can easily be represented anywhere in the world, and to keep the old restrictions and barriers is now outdated. We need to, of course, emphasize our religion and our religious teachings, but that should come through preaching and leaving it open for people to adopt or not adopt the faith depending on their choice. And because we believe our faith is so reasonable and just and fair, we believe that if the preaching of Islam continues as it should be, then people will naturally embrace this religion. We do not need to protect lands and enforce boundaries in which somehow we think by doing so we're going to preserve the religion. The religion is not preserved that way. It's preserved by the open declaration and teaching of the faith.
Thank you for that, Dr. Spiro.
You're welcome.
Loved this video. I mean, I could sit here and talk about what was said in the video, but what I want to do is I'm going to give a shout out to everyone that's always in our comments being kind, the people that are out there that watch our videos and give us stuff to do, and just those ones that are out there doing good. What I'm trying to say is a big shout out to the Muslims that are out there not being rude for no reason, because the religion doesn't allow that. And not those that are ignorant, not those that are going to bully people, not those that are just going to say, no, we have to be biased or we have to be racist or whatever the case is. A big shout out to everyone that can look past someone not having or believing in the same God that you do. A big shout out to all those that understand that and still preach or give us stuff to do because they want us to learn on our own. And when we're ready, we can do what's supposed to be done. Otherwise, like I said, a big shout out to all the kind people out there, all the kind people that are watching our videos, and just all the kind people that are treating people right and not discriminating against anyone. Make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course, do not forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in my next reaction video.